morning, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I am very thankful to Dr. Anil, who has provided me this opportunity to speak before you. This is a technician's attempt in this area. My topic is remote sensing application in wind energy. These are the outline of my presentation. Now, until now, we were doing wind resource assessment using the conventional methods of anemometry, installing tall mast and putting the anemometer, direction sensor and data logger. So this is conventionally followed all over the world. Now, slowly, remote sensing techniques are also introduced in the area of wind resource assessment. And there are very strong reasons behind it. Like, we are going for higher and higher heights. Modern wind turbines are coming in the range of 5 megawatt capacity. We have started with, say, 10 kilowatt, 100 kilowatt, 1 megawatt machine. Now, 5 megawatt. Machine is very much, wind turbines are very much going to be installed all over the world. Then there is also a lot of talk about repowering. Whatever existing wind farms are there, the machines are installed almost 15 years back or 20 years back. Now we are replacing with modern wind turbines which are having half height, going up to say 120 meters or even tip of the blade when it is in vertical position, it goes up to higher up to 200 meters. And that too, that is one aspect is repowering. Other is the whatever normal land is already, installation is already over. Now we are looking for complex terrain, for remote areas, for mountainous terrain. So there is a lot of turbulence in these areas. So when we are using the conventional method of cup anemometer, then it is only measuring at a point. Now we want to measure in a plane or in a volume. So this remote sensing technique is very much relevant to have this representative value of wind parameters like wind speed, direction and turbulence. So here we have forested and complex terrain, offshore sites. Now we are also looking for offshore sites. So this is very much relevant. And now the cost of the tower, the conventional tower is going high and high, approximately to the third power of height. Then licensing permission of installation of high mat mast is also very time consuming. And every time you have to shift the mast, say after 2-3 years of wind monitoring, you have to shift the mast. So again you have to install a new mast. This shows the conventional method of doing it. This is a typical wind monitoring station where the instruments are installed and there is a data logger. So this is how we are doing it. Now we are introducing the remote sensing. This is a typical tower. For example, for a 5 megawatt wind turbine, the wind speed at 100 meter height by a single cup anemometer is not a representative value. And the rotor diameter may expand beyond 120 meters. So cup anemometer is only a point measurement device. This is the focus of my talk. The rotor blade tip from lower most point to the upper most point goes from 50 meter lower point up to the 200 meter point. Then if we use this remote sensing technique, basically sonar and LIDAR, we can probe height up to say 1 kilometer or 2 kilometer, and suppose we probe at 100 meter height, then we can have a sampling volume in the order of 1000 meter cube. So instead of single point value, we can scan the whole volume. So whatever wind speed and direction and turbulence is coming, that will be more representative. Again, that same example, I have taken 5 megawatt wind turbine. So rotor span is 120 meter, and it goes beyond that. Then wind flow over the entire rotor plane. So multi-point and multi-height wind measurement is required. Remote sensing technique is now available for our requirements. So there is a justification for this because the cost is very high for remote sensing techniques. Now, if we see our country, we are having large area where wind resources available, and we want to go for different geographical regions to develop the wind power. This is very, very important because if we concentrate only in one area, then wind may not be blowing in that area. So the power output is zero. So we have to spread our wind farms all over the country in geographical regions. Then you see the coastal line is very, very large, more than 3,000 kilometers of coastal line is there. So wind resource assessment, that is remote sensing, can supplement as well as replace the tall map mass for global wind resource for in plains, over hilly and mountainous region, coastal area, offshore. Then evaluating various wind flow models, we can do this. So earlier we are doing point-wise, now we can scan vertically and horizontally as well as in three-dimensional in a volume. We can develop wind atlas and mapping in micro level, say in a wind farm, or in a macro level, say in a few square kilometers, or in country level, or in a global scale, and particularly for offshore. This is very, very relevant. Then power curve verification of wind turbine. Earlier we are using this curve anemometer single point measurement and installing the curve anemometer 2 to 3 diameter upstream of the wind turbine and measuring it. Now this powerful technique is available where we can scan the vertical and radial direction. So wind turbine online and forward speed control is also possible, like yaw control and blade pitching. The remote sensing technique can be applied and it can be work as a online between the wavelength of frequency distribution of the incoming and outgoing received signal, and due to this Doppler shift, we can measure the wind direction as well as turbulence. So this is well established remote sensing technique which we are using in GIS, GPS. Now it can be used for wind energy. Sonar is a sound-based technique where sound waves are used, and it works on the same principle of Doppler shift. Then we can measure wind speed, direction, as well as turbulence. These basic three parameters are required for wind resource assessment and use in the wind energy. It is based, solar is again based on auto frequency technology, and it can flow, say, up to up to 2 kilometers of height aloft the atmosphere. This is a typical solar instrument. Height at which wind speed is measured will be determined by the delay in time in the back scatter of the transmitted pulse. So there is a pulse is transmitted and received back. So there is a time delay, and wherever we can focus, that time delay will tell us at which height we are focusing it. So at which height we are measuring the wind parameters, the speed, direction, and turbulence. For example, the backscatter of sound wave for a height of 170 meter above the ground will be received back into the detector after delay of 1 second. So it depends on the speed of the sound. Now, wind speed is a function of Doppler shift. So this basic principle is used for measuring the wind speed in the direction of the sound wave or in the direction of light wave. It can be used for direct control of wind turbine by installing in the spinner of the hub. Then it can also work as a gust warning system for power optimization. Say, LiDAR or sonar system can be installed in the spinner, so it can sense the wind ahead of the wind turbine. So by the time wind front strikes the rotor, the pitching and yaw movement can be optimized. So in that way, you can also optimize the power or maximize the power output of the wind turbine. So it can work as an online or as a power grid control mechanism. Two types of solar systems are available. Monostatic and bistatic. Bistatic is rather better than monostatic system. Now, the only problem with the solar is the accuracy is not good for wind industry, but we can use it for basic studies or say for preliminary study, we can use solar equipment. And it is cheaper than LiDAR. LiDAR is nowadays it is in focus. Light waves propagation and backscatter detection and ranging using laser beam is very, very powerful and accurate method. This gives you the direct measurement of speed, direction, and turbulence. Scattering of light from small aerosols suspended or moving in atmosphere. So aerosols are moving with the same velocity as the wind is moving. It is based on this principle. Now this laser is we are using in the wavelength of 1.5 micrometer, which is safe for our eyes, so there is no harm except using this laser. LiDAR, there are two basic principles. All the LiDAR instruments are based on these two basic principles, continuous wave and pulse wave. Continuous wave is having higher spatial resolution, so it can be used for turbulence measurement. And pulse is good for multiple heights as well as for high ranges. So it is good for pulse radar is good for better for speed measurement and direction measurement. Then we are having wind profiler, which can give which this technology and instrument can be used for vertical wind speed, direction, and turbulence profile aloft in the atmosphere. Say up to 2 kilometers, 3 kilometers of the atmosphere, as well as for the temperature profile. It has transmitter and receiver antennas combined in a single optical telescope. So wherever you focus this thing, it will work like a camera, and it can focus aloft in the atmosphere, and at the point of focus, you will measure these parameters. LiDAR is having higher frequency, obviously, because it is based on laser light, and light is 6 times faster than sound wave. And this is one of the very good use, that it can be mounted in a spinner or in a blades. LiDAR instrument can be mounted. And it can sense the wind front 300 to 400 meters ahead of rotor. And by the time wind strikes, blade, it can activate the pitch of the blade, or it can also work as a forward field control as well as online for the nacelle yaw control. So due to these, the power performance of the wind turbine will improve. Then it will also reduce the fatigue loading on the blades, because it can sense the gust also ahead of the wind turbine. Now it is based on volume average measurement, so more representative than point-based galvanometer. It is mobile instrument, so it is better suited for onshore as well as offshore applications. For offshore, we can install it on small boats and platforms. Then there is another technology for offshore, particularly for offshore wind assessment. Is spectrometer, spectrometry, where we can see the waves on the surface of the sea from the satellite. And because waves are generated due to the wind speed, so this is an indirect measurement along the our sea surface. So we can see the waves, heights of the waves. So heights of the waves will be proportional to the wind speed and direction. So this scatterometry is also one of the technique, relationship technique. That is satellite based as well as radar based. The ranges for sonar is 200 to 600 meter, and for radar technique it can go up to 2 kilometers. These are the signal processing. I'm not going to detail for this. The conclusion is concept of rotor equivalent wind speed is more realistic than hub height single point reference wind speed for power curve verification as well as for assessment and quantification of the kinetic energy. So we can scan the whole rotor area and then have the multi-point measurement in the rotor area. So that will be more representative rather than measuring at one or two points or three points. LIDAR and sonar is used with map mask for initializing and calibration measuring the wind characteristics. So you need a high map mask for calibration purpose only. Single map mask is used for calibration purpose of the sonar and LIDAR.